Alright, excellent. So I like to take pictures of my audiences. So I see lots of people taking pictures of the slides. So everyone smile. One more. There we go. Click. Yes. Check. What's going on? Alright, that's now immortalized on Twitter. So if you use Twitter, on Twitter, just look for yourself in the picture. So, I'm here to tell you about some interesting stuff I've been doing with Michael Mahoney at Berkeley recently. I'm just going to sort of start with a little philosophy and some high-level motivation for the more specific stuff we'll look at a little bit later. But there's a sort of general graph-based data analysis pipeline that a lot of people look at, and usually it starts with something like a graph, and then you do something on the graph. So you figure out what the important nodes are, and the features, clustering, and all sorts of other fun stuff. So this isn't actually quite right. So we all usually say we start with a graph, but really we start with some type of raw data, and then at some point this raw data gets translated into a graph. And so there's a whole bunch of variety of ways that this is done. We'll see a couple of them in the rest of the talk. But what I want to tell you is that in some sense, that first step is actually introducing some interesting noise into your problem. So you might say, okay, I work in an area where I really have a graph. So there is some graph that I'm working with, except that probably still not quite true. So if you think of something like an explicit graph, you might think of a social network as being a graph that really exists. Except what groups do you choose to include in the social network that you analyze? So for instance, do you include ways to know if they're a country or not? Probably those are going to be separate. Do you include ways that people haven't been logged in 3 years? I don't know. Suffice it to say, there's a whole bunch of decisions that some point someone made, and then they handed you a graph file, and you're saying all this stuff that happens on my graph is somehow different than what this original process was. And so we're just going to take that as some kind of noise. There are also graphs you sort of explicitly build from data. So these are BS neighbor graphs, the kernel graphs, and there's all sorts of a variety of constructions that people do here, including truncating small things to zero, only using close nearest neighbors, symmetrizing graphs, et cetera, et cetera. Sometimes these decisions are actually meant for computational convenience as opposed to any sort of underlying data reasoning. Might be that your system can only handle so many pictures. This is just a different type of noise from our perspective in this talk. And then there are the labels that you might have on the nodes. So we're going to see a sentence supervising any problem on graph, in which case there are some labels on the nodes. But there could be errors in those labels. So it really works if you get one file in from the next. And we're not quite sure how trustworthy all the labels that we have on the nodes are. So this is sort of a direct type of noise. But you might say, okay, doesn't all of the algorithms, don't all of the algorithms handle these things nicely? Well, the answer is sort of no. If you sort of tweak these algorithms and these properties, you actually get very different answers. So if you go back to that picture, we sort of all like looking over here, but in some sense, the potential of your algorithm is determined at the step that you might not have thought about. Hopefully you have, but we're going to sort of try to play with a little bit of a structured setting. So more specifically, we want to know how does this graph creation process affect some of the outcomes, and is there anything we can do to make it slightly more robust? And I'll emphasize that robustness is actually a very useful property here, because a lot of this stuff gets rolled into some much bigger pipeline. You might say, oh, everything should be cross-validated and trained, and yes, that's probably a good theory. I mean, these pipelines get very complicated, so it's not clear how much training and other stuff goes into them. Totally different stuff. There is a class of scalable graph analytics that essentially works by localizing algorithms in terms of a large graph. And so what that means is that they run an algorithm in a graph, but they don't ever look at the entire graph. So a very nice example of this is one of these studies where they're trying to push algorithms for approximating a patient diffusion or finding communities in a social network. You can find the community sort of around the node here, or sort of try and predict what else might have a focus function without ever looking at the entire graph. You just look at some small region of the algorithm and find that all automatically. So, sort of a bold out there conjecture that can't probably prove it, but these local methods all essentially regularize the original problem in some way. So, there's some type of regularization that's being applied to make it some lag algorithm. We actually have a proof that that's exact. But the idea would be these localized methods actually ought to be slightly more robust to noise in these different interactions. And sometimes this is intuitive because if you don't look at the entire graph, what happens over in China can possibly affect the spirit of Australia or the US or something like that. So, this will give you a little bit more concrete in terms of what we actually look at in our paper. So, we study some of these issues in the context of a fairly well-studied problem. You don't want to look at the latest and greatest news things. You want to look at something sort of old and boring to look at how much of an impact that doesn't have. So, we're going to look at semi-supervised learning on graphs. So, the first thing we're going to do is put all the methods we look at into a framework where we can sort of compare apples to apples and there's a nice two-method construct that we use to do that. We'll use that and then actually explain how to localize one of those resulting constructions. So, this will allow us to get a scalable algorithm for the problem as opposed to solving the linear system. Then we're going to actually look at how to make these sort of label bounding close to do more robust. And we still have a couple of interesting weaknesses in some of these semi-supervised learning methods. Just a quick reminder of what semi-supervised learning is. This is the problem of given a graph, given a few labeled nodes, predict the labels on the rest of the graph. So it's a sort of prototypical algorithm for this, or a reasonably standard approach. It's a run diffusion. Just one representative difference. In Java, you only treat the positive class, and with the ZGL and reference to, you actually do something with the positive and the negative labels. So I like these because they help our intuition about what's going on here. So, a couple of sort of facts about them. There's effectively implicit regularization of some of them. And so, implicit regularization is a sort of subtle idea. Usually, when you think of different things, you think of the regularization term as explicitly enforcing some type of model selection idea. In implicit regularization, what we're doing is we're saying your choice of objective function is actually regularizing your problem for you in a way that you may or may not have anticipated. So, for this data, all the things that's related to this thing called the move vector or log vector, if you want to be fancy. part of the analog of a single vector, if you want to find sets that are community-like or have low conductance that are somehow separated from the rest of the graph, but you want to find them around the seed node. So it's really going to do a whole bunch of other things in theory, but this is just one specific case that Taylor has looked at. It turns out that the Gauss diffusion is exactly doing one of these laws. And sometimes it's giving you this implicit localization on this seed set given by the transitions labels in this case. So what this means is that all other things being equal, we would actually expect the Gauss diffusion to be a little bit more robust. It has a sort of implicit regularization property. Regularization might help with the functional statistical point of view. Second point, that there's a scalable localized algorithm for Gauss diffusion. So this is, we can essentially use a variation on the Anderson transition algorithm I mentioned as a good example. It's a localized algorithm for the last time called the Quick procedure. But we can use that to solve the Gauss diffusion really scalably. When I say scalably, I mean you can run a billion words on your laptop in just like 500 milliseconds or so. So this is incredibly fast. So for proof of that, we discuss that specific result in the maximal paper. But what we wanted to study here was essentially the importance too, which is, again, when you do this, it turns out that you're actually implicitly regularizing your objective function. So this was the spectral minor formulation. When you run this algorithm, what you're actually doing is you're solving this other problem over here exactly. So although you're approximating a solution to this, you're exactly solving this problem, the second problem. And the second problem has a fairly classic one-point-like regularization term attached to it. So again, this is something that's implicit rather than regularization. You're not doing anything explicit here, but another choice is implying that you've regularized your relation. So again, we would expect this to be slightly more robust. Okay, so that's a little bit of some new interpretations there. Just want to go through a couple of the issues with traditional. What we did for statistical device learning traditionally is how do you go from the diffusions back to our classes? If you look at the values of the diffusion. So here we've got a really simple problem. What we do is we say, oh, we're going to predict everything that applies to class 1, class 1, something for class 2, class 3. And here you get the right answer. As you vary diffusions, what happens is you actually get the wrong answer a lot of the time. So what happens is, for instance, in this diffusion, you end up predicting class 3, whereas you would actually like to predict class 1. You end up predicting class 1, whereas you'd like to have predicted class 3. But if you look at all of these, there's actually the right signal in each of those diffusions. The question is, how do you take advantage of it? There's all sorts of sort of neat ideas proposed to do this. We have a really simple one. Instead of using the value of the diffusion, sort the nodes and use the ranking in sort of list as the value instead. So there's actually a neat justification for this. It's if you have a spectral approximation to a cut and you turn that up into a cut, you need the ordering used by your vector, not the values against by your vector. Essentially, we're just pointing out the same idea here. And this can make a huge impact, but here's something you'll see a little bit more of later. But if you just run sort of a standard Gauss diffusion with a sort of localized version, you can see that you get a really nasty error rate. So, no more than 90% because Gauss is predicting one class in this case. If you run this push thing, it gets a little bit better, because this is all using value based ranking. If you just switch to rank based ranking, you can see that both of these algorithms do exactly the same. There's essentially no difference between them, and they both have much lower error rates. So, we're going to make a couple of empirical results here really quickly, so these are sort of studies in slightly more controlled settings. We wanted to try and figure out which type of diffusion you should use and which type of graph construction. So, where is the sort of lineup as far as giving you good examples here? Really simple two class block model here, same type of picture. If you have a sparse graph and you have a reasonably high error rate in your labels, this is the actually using dice, but that's where it's case because we have more and more labels. So we're just going to look at the balance of fusion, because that one seems to be the most representative of the real world scenarios, the sort of first draft, too many labels. What happens when we say density on one of these constructions? So here we have a digits construction with a kernel function. We can vary the kernel bit parameter, or we can vary the number of nearest neighbors to get different densities of our graphs. So if density increases, the results in this case just get a little bit worse. So as the kernel crosses, or as the kernel bandwidth crosses from threshold, we have a signal, we can work on it, but then as someone already pointed out, we work on it as small as possible. We don't want a big kernel length. The same thing happens for near neighbors. So essentially, we want this graph to be as sparse as possible. Another small observation is that we have questions with slightly more robust than the kernel. This is sort of a little bit annoying. I know how to set some of that optimized to use a ton of edges, and I'm telling you that you should use as few edges or as sparse of the graph as possible. How can you sort of add additional information into this and try and get better results? Because you can actually improve the results and get slightly better things. So we use the simplest idea that I ever think about for densifying the graph. We just did a simple path extension. So rather than using a GCC matrix, we just do a path extension at the path. And so then we pair parameters here and look at what happens as you look at different average degrees. And so all of these are statistically averaged over a whole bunch of different trials, and we're just looking at one thing here. But basically, we get the best results when we do a path expansion and have it by 4 on this using 3 nearest neighbors. So we take that information from the sparsest possible, graph that has its regular, and then spread it around. When you go in that densified graph, you actually get better results. Read more about this on the paper, but the same result effectively holds for AMLs purchasing networks. So there's a snap data set that really is a nearest neighbor construction on some graph at Amazon. As you densify that graph, by taking longer and longer path expansions, you get similar kinds of improvements in some type of trial difference. Interestingly, here we saw that most likely in this balance diffusion that we put diffusion and we tend to just be better overall. It still did a little bit better, but it really wasn't justified by the I'm out of time here, but we also paired with random theory for more aspects. So this is great. We've got a flow based setup for semi supervised learning. We've got new random rule that seems to do a lot more robustly. It's localized with one of these institutions to get empirical insights and the density of various constructions. A lot of this stuff translates to the way that fuzzy, directed, et cetera, et cetera. It translates to unfair or the middle of graph of the textures. One weakness is that we have a little bit more empirical results. I sort of like public theoretically jump private statements and we're a little light on those. It's going to be really like a theoretical basis for four applications. All the codes online. Thank you. So that's a great question. The question is, if there are ways to interpret the density equation, is this a different type of diffusion? And I think the answer is yes. The question would be, why is that type of diffusion better? It's a little subtle because the diffusions that we use in this are essentially conservative diffusions, so they model something spreading out and not creating new stuff, whereas the density equation is actually creating new things. So we're trying to figure that out, but essentially the same direction we're looking at. Okay, So the dimension of the network that we can run is something like the push algorithm on. We run them on networks with billions of nodes. Here we want a slightly more controlled setting. So the Amazon network, I think, has about a couple hundred thousand nodes and edges. And the digits data set is small, which means some of the construction, so we actually can utilize the whole depth from the only about 10,000 by 10,000. So in that case, it is a smaller scale study than we'd like, but it's a pretty well-understood focus.